Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio questions today is education skills. As ever, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers in order to get in as many members as possible. Question number one, I call Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to ensure that qualified teachers are able to find suitable employment through permanent teaching posts in Scottish schools.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
Local councils are responsible for the recruitment and deployment of their staff. This includes providing a complement of teachers who best meet the needs of each of their school pupils. While the employment of teachers is a matter for local authorities, the Scottish Government does remain committed to protecting teacher numbers and ensuring that qualified teachers are able to find suitable employment through permanent teaching posts. And we are providing local authorities with £145.5 million in this year's budget for that purpose.
Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Over the last couple of years, and particularly this year, I have had an increasing number of constituents who are teachers coming to me about this issue, advising that they cannot get permanent posts in North Lanarkshire Council or other councils and have to rely on supply teaching. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary what more can be done to ensure that those trained to teach our children to the high standards that we can be proud to have here in Scotland are able to do so? And what further discussions can she have with councils, including North Lanarkshire, to realise this potential further?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think it is worth noting that the Teacher Induction Scheme provides a one-year probationary placement to allow teachers to meet the standard for full registration. That does not, though, provide a guarantee of future employment with a particular council, but it is fully funded by the Scottish Government, and teaching posts require to be advertised and filled in a fair and a transparent manner. And I think it's also worthwhile reflecting that over the past 10 years, since 2014, the number of teachers in permanent posts has remained relatively stable at over about 80%. Now, while we cannot direct teachers where they should work, and nor would I want to, we will continue to do everything that we can to maximise the number of jobs that are available for teachers, including permanent posts. I've had substantive discussions with COSLA to that end. I've also asked the Strategic Board for Teacher Education to provide me with advice on how we can better understand and tackle this challenge at local authority level. I'm meeting with the board next week to talk to the progress they've made, and I expect to receive an initial report from them by the end of this year. I'm also happy to discuss this issue directly with North Lanarkshire Council, as I have with other councils. And of course, it is worthwhile saying, Presiding Officer, they do have responsibility
thank you,
for the employment
Secretary.
Of teachers.
I've got a number of supplementaries, and I'll try to get through as many as I possibly can in the time available. Supplementary, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In my constituency of Banffshire and Buchan Coast, we are seriously struggling to attract and retain teachers. The Scottish Government's incentives to encourage newly qualified staff to take up posts in rural areas are having limited success there. Parent councils in Aberdeenshire are calling for a summit to address these issues. But will the Cabinet Secretary please meet with me and the parents that are concerned about this to discuss it further?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Ms Adam for her question. I have actually met with parent council representatives from Aberdeenshire earlier this year. I've also met with a local authority directly, and we've looked this year at the way in which we provide allocations of the preference waiver scheme by doing that manually to increase the number of probationers, for example, this year going to Aberdeenshire. I think also worthwhile saying that post-pandemic, we are seeing fewer teachers engage in that scheme, and I've asked officials for advice on how we might be able to update and reflect on reviewing that scheme, because it's not working in the way I think it was intended. There are local challenges in Aberdeenshire. There are schools, though, as Ms Adam will know, like Banff Academy, who are using really pragmatic approaches to filling those vacancies, but I'm more than happy to meet with the member and with our constituents.
Supplementary, Liam Kerr.
In Angus, it's been reported that newly qualified primary teachers have next to no hope of getting permanent jobs. Only 10.5% are permanent after a year. They're stuck in a limbo of supply work, unable to buy a house, some report being unable to have a family, and some have been offered a refuse collection job as an alternative. Now, local figures suggest that Angus Council can't afford to employ the number of teachers it needs. So does the Cabinet Secretary recognise this government urgently needs to rethink how it resources education departments in Angus, take practical action of the sort that was absent from her previous answers to avoid further letting teachers and pupils down?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his interest. I did actually outline practical action that I've taken in the last year, which is that manually this year, officials have entered where those teachers who are ticking the box to go anywhere have been sent to authorities like Karen Adams constituency where there are vacancies. So that's a practical measure we've taken this year that sent more probationers to that part of the country. I'm more than happy to engage with the member on the issues in Angus. And of course, every local authority in Scotland is responsible for their own employment of teachers. They've all got different practices. Well, I see the member gesticulating at me about money, and again remind the member that we are providing an extra £145.5 million ring-fenced in this year's budget, which his party voted against, to protect teacher numbers. And if he wants me to put additional funding in that, I'm sure he will engage with me and with members across the government throughout the budget process on where that additionality might come from.
Supplementary, Pam Duggan-Clancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. That teaching has now become a precarious job is something most of us in Scotland never thought would be the case. Yet in 2016, half of post-induction teachers got jobs, and in 2022-23, that fell to less than a quarter. Presiding Officer, pupils and teachers both need stability. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, how did it get to this, and what will she do to make sure people who train as teachers get jobs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, look, I think I go back to the point I made in response to a previous member. The number of teachers today in permanent post is roughly the same as it was in 2014. I recognise some of the challenge here, and I think it's important that we work with local authorities like Angus, who have specific challenges, and like Aberdeenshire, who've got challenges around about subject areas. I've given an update to the Chamber previously, Presiding Officer, around about some of the work we've done on supporting bursaries for certain subject areas. I think we will have to consider that again, and I've also intimated in my response to a previous question that a meeting with the Strategic Board for Teacher Education next week to hear advice from them on how we can try to change some of the mood music around here. But I do reflect again, Presiding Officer, the additionality Scottish Government is putting in at the current time to protect teacher numbers that is helping to sustain permanence in many parts of the country, and without it we would see a much more challenging picture. I'm more than happy though to work with members of the Opposition on this and hear any ideas that they might have.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
I genuinely can't understand the government's policy now. It says it wants to recruit 3,500 teachers, even though local councils just cannot afford it. But then it floats the suggestion it could reduce teacher contact time without the 3,500 extra teachers. The result is unemployed and underemployed teachers right across the country. So what is the government's policy? Does it want 3,500 teachers or not?
Cabinet Secretary.
As Mr Rennie knows, we invest in Scotland's teachers, and I'm sure he welcomed, for example, the acceptance from the teaching trade unions only last week of the most recent pay offer, which is putting an extra £29 million into the pockets of teachers across the country. We invest in Scotland's teachers, and actually, if we look nationally at the numbers, since 2018, we've seen thousands more teachers in Scotland's schools, over 2,000 since 2018 alone. I also responded, Presiding Officer, to a previous member about the additionality we are ring-fencing at the current time. But I recognise the challenges here. To my mind, they are local and they often vary in relation to subject areas. I think we need to look again at the probationer scheme, for example, which is directly funded by this government. And I look forward to working with the Strategic Board for Teacher Education, who I'll be meeting next week.
Question number two, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its work to explore the feasibility of an island scholarship to support higher education students studying in Scotland's islands.
Minister Graeme Day.
Second Officer, the Scottish Government is aware of the important contribution that students bring to our island communities, and we want to create opportunities for them to apply their skills and remain on our islands after graduating. During my recent visit to Orkney, I spoke with Professor Sandy Kerr, who has been working with officials on the idea of an island scholarship. Whilst mindful of the current pressures on public finances, we agreed the proposal merits further consideration, and I requested more information from him, which he provided earlier this week.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank the Minister for that response, and indeed for the time he spent in Orkney last month. Orkney is an important and growing hub of renewables innovation, hosting world-leading firms, providing jobs and benefits to the local community, as well as supporting efforts to meet Scotland's wider just transition goals. Yet, since the recent withdrawal of the Funding Council grants for priority postgraduate top courses, the local energy sector is facing challenges recruiting skilled staff. Those grants provided huge benefits for relatively modest investment. So I would urge the Minister, who has now those proposals in more detail, to give positive consideration to them to ensure that both skills shortages and the risk of depopulation can be addressed through this investment.
Minister.
So let me give Liam MacArthur the assurance that the updated proposal from Professor Kerr, which only reached me in the last few days, will be given appropriate consideration. The public finances are in the most challenging state since devolution, and on first read-through, there may be one or two other potential issues around what's being proposed. However, as with any suggestion of this type, I'm coming at the matter prepared to consider it on its merits, and I recognise the genuine interest here on the part of Professor Kerr and Liam MacArthur, and I'll seek to keep the member updated on this.
Question number three, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to deliver better outcomes for children and young people with learning disabilities, autism and neurodiversity in light of its decision not to include the introduction of its proposed Learning Disabilities, Autism and Neurodivergence Bill in the programme for government for 2024-25.
Minister Natalie Dunn.
Although it has not been possible to include the Learning Disabilities, Autism and Neurodivergence Bill in the Year 4 programme, we remain absolutely committed to the bill and the need for legislation. We will be continuing with our work to develop the bill and have committed to publish draft bill provisions. Marie Todd will be meeting with the Bill Lived Experience panel and with stakeholders shortly to discuss the next steps and their involvement. In addition to developing the bill, we will continue with a range of work that is important to both younger people and adults who are neurodivergent or have learning disabilities. This includes the rollout of learning disability annual health checks, our work on neurodevelopmental pathways and work across government on issues raised in the bill consultation, including employment, education and transport.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? Many autistic people and families are disappointed that the LDAN bill has been delayed in this way, and this is especially the case for parents of autistic young people who are denied their right in education because of a lack of support. So can I ask the Minister if she will commit to bringing forward mandatory training for teachers regardless of whether or not the bill progresses? And I'm pleased to see a Health Minister is here as well today. A cross-party group of Lothian MSPs has written to the Government outlining our concerns with regards to waiting times for children in Lothian to receive a diagnosis and medication. So I hope there's issues which can be discussed across portfolio for constituents here in Lothian.
Minister.
Absolutely. We are aware of the issues raised in the letter and, of course, sorry to hear of these concerns. We want to make sure that neurodivergent people are getting the support they need. We acknowledge the need for better access and support for people who may have ADHD, that private assessments can lead to issues with medication, and that there are still UK-wide ADHD medicine shortages. We are working with all NHS health boards to improve neurodevelopmental support and pathways, and will engage with NHS Lothian on the contents of the letter. And I know that myself and Ms Todd would be happy to meet to discuss this further. In terms of the point regarding mandatory training, this has been considered in approaches to the additional support for learning action plan, and I'm happy to update the member as that progresses further.
Supplementary for Sir Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last year's Hayward Review, which we should be hearing about later today, noted that the creation of any new Scottish qualification should consider how it will impact learners with disabilities and additional support needs. Can the Minister outline if the Scottish Government plans to review educational bodies to ensure they are delivering positive outcome for pupils with disabilities and additional support in the undertaking of this qualification?
Minister.
This is a very important issue that Mr Chowdhury raises, and I know that there is work on that. I understand that the CabSec will provide an update on that shortly, and I will allow the Cabinet Secretary to do so.
And supplementary, Mark Roscoe.
Thank you. I'm sure that both the Minister and Jenny Gilruth are aware of the Neurodevelopmental Pathway Project in Fife, a multi-agency approach which enables children and families to get the support that they need while they're waiting for an assessment. When I visited a Fife school that was involved in the pilot a couple of years ago, it was quite clear it was really transforming the learning environment for young people, and it's really helping neurodiverse children to unlock their potential. So can I ask, has the government reviewed the impact of that particular pilot, and what consideration is being given to rolling out that kind of approach to other parts of Scotland?
Minister.
I am not aware of the current position on that, but I would be more than happy to look into that and get back to the member.
Question number four, Annie Wells, who's joining us remotely. Ms Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to encourage teacher retention during the current academic year.
The enhanced pay deal agreed last week ensures that Scotland's classroom teachers will continue to be the best paid in the UK, helping to support teacher retention and ensuring that children and young people's education will not be disrupted. Despite a challenging fiscal position, we have been able to support the deal this year with an additional £29 million being made available to allow for this improved offer, recognising the hard work that teachers put in to supporting our pupils right across Scotland. Ultimately, local authorities have statutory obligations in respect of education and should ensure that they employ the right number of teachers to meet local requirements.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Teachers in Glasgow are currently voting on industrial action in response to the SNP City Council's decision to cut 450 teaching posts over 3 years, which the EIS has described as damaging and dangerous. This comes as newly qualified teachers in Glasgow region are struggling to get jobs. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the SNP's underfunding of councils and failure to support the teaching profession will have irreversible impact on pupils in Glasgow?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank the member for her interest in this, and I think important to say, Presiding Officer, that any legal challenge will be a matter for the Council, so I just want to put that on the record. But fundamentally, my view is we do not want to see teacher numbers reduced in Glasgow or anywhere else in the country. That is why we are making available £145.5 million to councils to maintain teacher numbers this year. Now, Glasgow have been offered funding of £16.5 million for this financial year to maintain teacher numbers, which is their share of the funding I spoke to. In 24-25, though, Glasgow City Council will receive over £1.6 billion to fund local services, which equates to an extra £74.9 million to support vital day-to-day services, or an additional 14.9% compared to 23-24. So I don't accept the second part of the member's question. I do recognise the challenge here. She will recognise there is an ongoing legal challenge too that I cannot comment on. But what I am very much focused on doing as Cabinet Secretary is protecting this funding, because I think protecting teacher numbers is really important for improving the outcomes for our children.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Brief supplementary, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, the recruitment and retention of teachers are a matter for local authorities, and Annie Wells and the Tories will actually know this. But however, how is the Scottish Government investing in the education system to empower local authorities in this regard?
Cabinet Secretary. Well,
I think the member's correct. Councils are responsible fundamentally for making sure they have the right numbers of staff in place to meet local needs. We are, however, as I mentioned, Presiding Officer, supporting councils to ensure that Scotland continues to have the most teachers per pupil and the highest paid classroom teachers in the UK. We've provided record funding of over £14 billion to local councils this year alone, a real terms increase of 2.5% compared to the previous year, and that includes the £145.5 million that's been ring-fenced to protect teacher numbers, and £242 million to support the previous teacher pay deals. And as I set out in my answer to Annie Wells, we've also made available £29 million during this financial year to support the teachers' pay deal.
And brief supplementary, Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I hear very clearly what the Cabinet Secretary is saying about protecting teacher numbers, but can I ask her directly, does this mean the SNP have abandoned their manifesto commitment to add additionally 3,500 new teachers? Has this policy been abandoned, yes or no?
Well, I thank the member for his question. What I've set out, of course, is the investment this government is putting in to maintain teacher numbers at the current time. I would like to go further, and I look forward to hearing the budget proposals coming from the Conservatives to that end to support that additionality. Well, I hear the member heckling from a sedentary position, Presiding Officer, but if he wants me to put in extra funding to support extra teacher numbers, as of course the new Labour government have committed to elsewhere, then he will have to identify where in the Scottish Government's budget that additionality should come from.
Members, could we not have all this chuntering, please? Let's just try to make some progress. Excuse me? Question number 5, Brian Whistle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to ensure that green skills are embedded in the provision of further education.
Minister Graeme Dey.
Well, Presiding Officer, further education in the work of our colleges is critical to ensuring we have the skills needed to deliver on our climate goals. The Funding Council's Net Zero and Sustainability Framework is supporting the sector's work to enable Scotland's workforce to develop the high-quality, lifelong skills needed for the transition. With funding from the Scottish Funding Council, the Energy Skills Partnership acts as the college sector lead for the transition to net zero, supporting institutions in developing their capability, capacity and curriculum pathways. Our work on skills planning will further help develop the approach to green skills.
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but key to delivering climate change targets will be delivering a future workforce that matches that delivery need. Further education sector has the capability to deliver the apprenticeships that businesses across the engineering and trade sector are crying out for, as well as upskilling those transferring to renewables. But the Audit Scotland report on colleges just published said there's a lack of leadership and direction on reform from the Scottish Government. So what can the Scottish Government do to better align the future Scottish Government policy with FE sector delivery and ensure that the output from colleges matches the workforce needs for future green economy skills?
Minister.
Green skills provision is already part of the offering of the FE sector in Scotland, with colleges such as West Lothian and South Lanarkshire excellent examples of that. But it's imperative that the green skills offer aligns with the needs of what is an evolving sector, Brian Whittle's right. And to that end, I was greatly encouraged when attending a meeting of the Scottish Offshore Wind Energy Council yesterday to hear about the very detailed and advanced work of their skills and energy group in identifying current and predicted skills needs, particularly in the offshore arena, work being carried out in conjunction with the university and college sectors. It's that very direct partnership working actively encouraged and supported by this government, which will ensure that the right green skills are on offer from our institutions.
And brief supplementary, Colin Beattie.
Can I ask the Minister how organisations like Lantra Scotland are assisting with the provision of green skills-related courses in the further education sector, and how the Scottish Government supports this?
Minister.
Officer, Lantra plays a key role in delivering green skills by supporting skilling, upskilling and retaining workers in the land-based, aquaculture and environmental conservation sectors. These sectors contribute to just transition to net zero by increased carbon capture through regenerative farming practices, forestry and restoration of our peatlands. The Scottish Government funds Lantra Scotland's 2024-25 work plan, enabling the organisation, amongst other things, to distribute practical training funds, for example, Women in Forestry and Future Foresters funds, that support applicants to acquire the green skills they need to develop their careers.
Question number six, Ros McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taking to improve school attendance of care-experienced young people.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm committed to supporting improved school attendance for all young people, and I asked Education Scotland to undertake a deep dive to support greater understanding of this issue. Recently, their report includes 5 recommendations to improve practice. Education Scotland and the Scottish Government are working together to support those actions, including an online package of support designed with local authorities and schools. In addition, Education Scotland are working with councils to provide practical support. The first cohort of the Improving Attendance Quality Improvement Programme will begin shortly. I've also asked the Chief Inspector for Education to identify successful approaches which can be shared more widely as part of inspections. Finally, I read with interest the Children's Commissioner for England's report on children and young people's attendance, and I hope to meet with Dame D'Souza to discuss that soon. Officials have been working with COSLA and ADES on the development of a framework for education to support improved educational outcomes for care-experienced children and young people, including their attendance.
Ros McCall.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The findings contained within the Permanently Progressing Building Secure Futures for Children report from the University of Stirling is deeply concerning. Their study found out that out of the 1,836 participants, it was not possible to link educational attendance, exclusion and absence data to the study for a whopping 1,086 of them. 60% in this study did not have a Scottish candidate number. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that children are issued with an SEN when they start school, but this was not available for the majority of the cohort, so linkage to educational data was not possible. Cabinet Secretary, what more is the Scottish Government doing to ensure our data gathering is robust, includes all children that have experienced care, and how can we ensure that the promise is going to be fulfilled if we don't have the appropriate data sets?
Thank you. I think the Cabinet Secretary's got the gist. Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for the issue that she's raised. I think it's a hugely important point, and I very much recognise the importance of the SCN number and that being used as a data set, essentially, to gather information on young people and to track their progress through the educational system. So I'm concerned by what she's outlined to me today. I'm more than happy to engage with her directly on that. I should put on the record, though, that in relation to the promise, I am recused as my wife sits on the implementation board.
And I can take two supplementaries if both members are very brief. First, Audrey Nicol.
You, Cabinet. Presiding Officer, beg your pardon. Can the Cabinet Secretary set out some of the reasons why there's been an increase in anxiety and other reasons causing young people to be less able to engage in their education than was previously the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's clear, Presiding Officer, and as we've discussed across the Chamber in recent months, that the pandemic continues to have an impact on behaviour in schools and has impacted on children and young people in lots of different ways. It was a very significant life event, and it has impacted on social and emotional development. It's affected the transition between primary and secondary, and it's caused an increase in relation to anxiety about physically attending school. We know from the BISR research that other impacts include, for example, the increased use of mobile phone use, and I've set out some of the response to that in the weeks prior to us returning to Parliament, Presiding Officer. But I will continue to work with our school leaders on how we can best support our young people and our teachers post-pandemic, because those effects are still being felt in our schools today.
And brief supplementary, Martin Pickard.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I have no intention of embarrassing the Cabinet Secretary, so could I ask the Department to write, following the publication today, on keeping the promise, what work is being done on Promise in Education framework, which deals with absenteeism of care-experienced children?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm more than happy to write to the member. I'll ask my minister to write to the member with that information.
And I can squeeze in questions 7 and 8, but I need brief questions and answers. Question 7, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the levels of funding for tertiary education are adequate to support a thriving sector.
Minister Graeme Day.
We recognise the crucial role of our universities and colleges in providing post-school education and skills, which is why, despite the most challenging fiscal position since devolution, we've allocated around £2 billion to both colleges and universities this year. This demonstrates a long-term commitment supporting the delivery of high-quality education, training and research. But we also continue discussion on joint priorities, including funding with the sectors and the Scottish Funding Council through our tripartite groups.
Maurice Golden.
Thank the Minister for that answer. The university sector isn't a homogeneous group, and there will be different challenges facing larger and smaller institutions, not least of all because smaller institutions are more dependent on SFC funding. Does the Minister recognise this, and if so, can he explain what specific measures have been put in place to ensure the needs of smaller institutions are being met?
Minister.
As a member will understand, I regularly have a number of institutions seeking to advance a case for more favourable treatment than is currently the situation. But of course, the funding envelope is the funding envelope that we have. If we distribute it more generously in one direction, it means less for others. I've had conversations with a number of universities in this regard. But what I can commit to is working more closely with the university as a collective as we negotiate the budget process that's coming up, trusting that the suggestions that they bring forward reflect as far as is possible the collated asks of the sector.
And question number 8, Bob Doris.
The Scottish Government how it supports wraparound care for school-aged children in Glasgow, Maryhill and Springburn constituency.
Minister Natalie Dunn.
Glasgow is one of our childcare early adopter community areas, being supported by £16 million investment over the next 2 years, as set out in the programme for government. It includes work in the Canal Ward and Mr Doris constituency to expand access to affordable school-aged childcare services for targeted families most at risk of living in poverty. We're also funding activities services in the area through our Extra Time programme with the SFA, as well as supporting stepping stones for families to deliver affordable school-aged childcare and wider family support services in Postle Park.
Bob Doris.
I commend that investment, Minister. I am fortunate my son benefits from an excellent breakfast club from 8 a.m. and after-school provision till 6 p.m. when required, both provided by Somerston Childcare. However, can I ask how the Scottish Government tracks the unmet need and demand for such services, not only in Maryhill, but right across the country? And importantly, how does the Scottish Government map out progress in addressing those gaps when identified?
Minister.
So there are a number of work streams in relation to this. At local level, all local authorities have a statutory duty under the Children Scotland Act to consult with parents about their school-aged childcare needs every 2 years and to prepare and publish plans in relation to the provision of appropriate care. In addition, through those 6 childcare early adopter communities, we're co-designing local childcare systems to meet parents' and carers' need, understanding that this will look different in each community. At a national level, the Scottish Government has been working with Improvement Service and Assist FM to map breakfast and after-school club provision across all 32 local authorities and to identify any gaps in that provision. We will continue to work with our partners across local government to understand what it takes to expand access to year-round school-aged childcare, building on the provision that's already in place and respecting local flexibilities.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes portfolio questions on education and skills. There will be a very brief pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position. Thank you.